Hey, good afternoon, everybody. So we have three more lectures having to do with the infectious cycle, and then we move into disease, pathogenesis, prevention. So actually the hardest part of the course is past. And today I want to talk about several impossible or seemingly impossible things. Reverse transcription. We have alluded to viruses that encode reverse transcriptase, and today we're going to dig really deeply into them. These viruses that we'll talk about today were discovered at the turn of the 1900s, chicken leukemia virus in 1908, and Rouse sarcoma virus, 1911. That was discovered by Peyton Rouse, not Peyton Manning, Peyton Rouse. And he was a scientist at the Rockefeller Institute, got the Nobel Prize 50 years later for this work. We're going to revisit this finding later on in the course as it relates to causing viruses, causing tumors. Really, really neat stuff. So these were both called tumor viruses. They turn out to be two different kinds of tumor viruses. Tumor viruses were later found to have RNA genomes. As we will see later, there are also DNA tumor viruses, but these RNA tumor viruses were the first to be discovered. And they had a very interesting property. Not only did they cause tumors in birds, that's the ones that were initially discovered, but they also transformed cells. They changed the properties of cells in culture. They allowed them to grow forever, for example. How could viruses do that? This was a puzzle for many years until 1970, when reverse transcriptase was discovered in the particle of these RNA tumor viruses that had been identified by Peyton Rouse and Bang and Olufsen in the early 1900s. So these two individuals, Howard Temin and David Baltimore, independently discovered reverse transcriptase in these RNA tumor viruses, and that led them to be called retroviruses. They got the Nobel Prize for that in 1975. So this enzyme went counter to the central dogma, which was always thought to be you go from DNA to RNA to protein. This enzyme, reverse transcriptase, took RNA and made DNA from it. So this was totally unusual and had never been seen before. And that's why they got their name, reverse transcriptase, because they reversed the flow of genetic information, and retroviruses because they contain reverse transcriptase. And yes, there is a rock band named Retrovirus. It's playing tomorrow night here. If you go and you show me proof, I will give you extra credit for the course. All right. It's too late for me, but you guys might go. Retrovirus, there you go. You think they know anything about retroviruses and where the name came from? There you go. All right, so on the Baltimore scheme of things, here are retroviruses up here. They have a plus-stranded RNA genome, but this plus-strand is not translated when it gets into the cell. It is instead copied to a DNA copy for single and then double-stranded DNA. And that is done by reverse transcriptase, which is in the particle. All right, and then, of course, the DNA is transcribed to form mRNA. We will explore how this is done. This enzyme has revolutionized science, okay? It is not an overstatement. Almost everything that we can do today in molecular biology, life sciences, is because of reverse transcriptase. We are able to clone genes because of this enzyme. We are able to do quantitative polymerase chain reaction. So many things brought about by this enzyme. It is just phenomenal. And in the biology of these viruses, it's also very interesting. And that's what I want to tell you about today. So here are Temin in Baltimore. I can't see it, so I have to go up here. They independently discovered reverse transcriptase. Here's Howard Temin. He was at the University of Madison, Wisconsin, for his entire career. He identified RNA-dependent DNA polymerase in virions of Rouse sarcoma virus. So the original virus that Rouse discovered, he worked on in his laboratory. And he talks in the abstract for his paper about how these these RNA tumor viruses are sensitive to actinomycin D. That's a drug that prevents DNA-dependent RNA synthesis. And he figured that these viruses somehow put a copy of their genome into the cellular DNA and that this enzyme was essential for doing that. And Baltimore came to the same conclusions independently. RNA-dependent DNA polymerase in virions of RNA tumor viruses. And he also said there's an essential DNA intermediate in the life cycle of these viruses. And this enzyme makes perfect sense to convert these virus genomes into DNAs that can be inserted into that of the host cell. So for our 100th podcast many years ago, we interviewed David Baltimore, and he gave his little personal insight about how he did this and so forth. So you might want to check that out. Now, Howard Temin was really ahead of the game here. So he thought these viruses transform host cells. So we will talk about transformation later, what that means, but essentially you're changing the genetic makeup of the cell. So he said there has to be a way for these viruses to convert their RNA genomes into DNA, which then becomes part of the host cell. That's why he went looking for this enzyme, because he thought it had to be there, and he indeed found it. So his idea was that the DNA became a permanent part of the host, and he called that the provirus. So remember that word, proviral DNA. The provirus is a copy of the RNA tumor virus, a DNA copy, which is integrated into the host cell genome. So these are what some retroviruses look like. There are all different sorts. We tend to group them into retroviruses with simple genomes and retroviruses with complex genomes. This is one with a simple genome. Here are the particles. They're enveloped. They tend to have a dark staining core or nucleocapsid. And on the right, you can see the makeup of the particle. So there's an envelope which is full of glycoproteins. And the main glycoprotein is composed of two parts, which is called SU, or surface, and TM, transmembrane. There's a protein beneath the membrane called the matrix protein. There's a capsid inside, a nucleocapsid, and the RNA genome, you can see here, is in green. There are two copies of the RNA genomes. These viruses are diploid, so to speak. And there are a number of other proteins in the virion. There's reverse transcriptase here, the blue one. There's an integrase molecule, and we're going to talk about those today. And there's also a protease. And here's a schematic of the genome at the top. This is in the DNA form, and we'll talk about how that compares to the RNA form. This DNA is transcribed by the host cell to form the viral mRNA, and that's shown right here. So this is a full-length viral mRNA transcribed from the viral DNA. It has essentially three sets of genes for these retroviruses with simple genomes: GAG, POL, and envelope. Some of them are translated from this unspliced mRNA. And how this gets out of the nucleus, we talked about last time, how the retroviruses get unspliced mRNAs out of the nucleus. They're not supposed to be able to do that, but they can do it. And this mRNA is translated just to form the GAG and the GAG-POL precursors. There's actually a stop codon after GAG that's suppressed part of the time to give you a fusion. So you can get GAG, which is the structural precursor, and the polymerase, which encodes the reverse transcriptase. To get the envelope protein, that's the glycoprotein in the virion, this message has to be spliced to form this mRNA, and that gives you envelope. So you have a single splice that gives rise to envelope, but the unspliced precursor gets out of the nucleus and is translated into the structural and enzymatic proteins. So here's the life cycle of these retroviruses, the simple ones that we're talking about. Anyway, they attach to receptors. Many of them fuse at the cell surface and put their nucleocapsid into the cytoplasm. That contains the viral RNA. The reverse transcriptase is brought along with the virion, so it starts to copy. The RNA makes a double-stranded DNA copy, which goes into the nucleus of the cell. It integrates into the host cell genome. So purple represents host cell DNA. And the blue is the retroviral DNA. So it's integrating into the host cell genome. And there, it is copied by host DNA polymerase to make the mRNAs. And as I said before, some of them are exported without being spliced. that give rise to the GAG and the GAG pole proteins, and some of them are spliced to give rise to the envelope glycoprotein. How these viruses mature and assemble, we'll talk about in two lectures. Reverse transcriptase is a nucleic acid polymerase very much like all the other ones we've talked about so far. It has a few unique properties. The primer can be DNA or RNA. The primer has to have a paired 3' hydroxy terminus. The template, even though this is a reverse transcriptase that copies RNA to DNA, the template can be DNA because once the RT makes a single-stranded DNA copy of the RNA, it makes that double-stranded as well. So it can copy RNA or DNA. It uses deoxyNTPs, not rNTPs, so it makes only DNA. And of course, the correct NTP is selected by base pairing, which is true for all polymerases. RTs, reverse transcriptases, are really everywhere. They're in bacteria and archaea. In fact, in bacteria, I just learned last year that reverse transcriptases give rise to diversity in certain proteins of the bacteria. So these are quite old proteins. So they must have arisen before the separation of these three kingdoms of life. So they're present in some common precursor because bacteria, archaea, and eukaryotes all have reverse transcriptases. And some people believe that this is the enzyme that evolved to create the DNA world. Remember I told you a long time ago that we believe, or some believe, that the first world that of life that evolved was an RNA world, where genomes consisted of RNA. That eventually evolved into a DNA world, and perhaps reverse transcriptase was part of that. So it's quite an old enzyme. It's very similar to all the other polymerases that we've looked at. We have so far in this course looked at RNA-dependent RNA polymerases. We have looked at DNA polymerases. We have looked at DNA-dependent RNA polymerases. Just did that last week. And today we're looking at the RNA-dependent DNA polymerases. This is an alignment of all of them. You can see there are conserved motifs shown in green in the active center motif of these enzymes, which is a palm. These all look like right hands with palm and fingers domains. Remember, there are amino acid signatures for different polymerases. And the reverse transcriptases tend to have an ASP in that C strand. And remember, that is for coordinating the two magnesium ions. This is two metal catalysis, just like all the other polymerases. A second activity, besides reverse transcriptase, the ability to copy RNA into DNA, these enzymes have a second activity built into the same protein. And that's called RNase H. This is a very important enzyme. This cleaves RNA when it's in a double-stranded form. All right, and it can be RNA-RNA or RNA-DNA, doesn't really matter. It is an endonuclease. It cleaves internally. It doesn't chop from the ends. It cleaves internally, as you can see here, and produces short pieces of RNA with 5' phosphates and 3' hydroxyls. So each red arrow is where this enzyme would cleave, and you can see it cleaves between the O and the P. And this is important for removing the RNA template during reverse transcription, as you will see. So that's RNase H. It's part of the same polypeptide as the reverse transcriptase. So here on the top is a model of the enzyme. This is based on X-ray crystallography. And it looks like a right hand. As I said, it has palm and fingers and thumb domains. And here we're showing a template and primer going through the active site of the enzyme right here. And here's the next NTP, which is going to be polymerized into the chain. So this is the reverse transcriptase active site of the enzyme. The RNase H domain is out here to the upper right. And it's easier to see on this lower cartoon. Here is a diagram of the entire enzyme. Here's the active site of the polymerase. And we are showing an RNA in green coming into the active site and a single strand of DNA being synthesized and coming out here the other end. Now, as the duplex passes through the enzyme, it passes the RNase H active site, which is down here to the right, and this RNA is chopped away. So what emerges from the enzyme is a single strand of negative sense DNA. Remember, because the genome is plus-stranded, it's copied into a negative sense DNA. So again, RNase H is degrading the template. It's not needed anymore. It's just needed to make that DNA strand, and it has both activities in the same polypeptide. This is a very slow enzyme. It does not make bases very quickly. It takes about 4 hours to make one copy of the viral genome. To make one single strand takes 4 hours, and it makes a lot of mistakes. It makes an error every 10,000 or up to 10,000 up to a million base pairs. Yes. Sorry, where is that?
So it says thumb and then to the left it says Fe2+.
Metal, that just means metal.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because sometimes you can substitute other metals for magnesium. But magnesium is the biologically relevant metal, but you can put other things in there. All right, so it's a slow and mistake-prone enzyme, not unlike other RNA polymerases. All right, time for a question. Question is, reverse transcriptase has revolutionized molecular biology. Which statement about the enzyme is not correct? Okay, number one is winning, and if scattered answers at all the others. So number one, of course, is not correct. It is not unique to retroviruses. Many bacteria, many archaea, and many eukaryotes have reverse transcriptase. It's not unique to retroviruses. It's packaged in the particle. It has RNase H activity. The name, of course, comes from reversing the flow, and it might have bridged the RNA world with the contemporary one, the DNA world. All right, let's take a look at reverse transcription. This is a pretty neat process. It's really amazing that this evolved. Now, the virus particle on the upper left has two copies of the RNA genome. They're shown here. They're capped, and they're polyadenylated. And here are the coding regions, GAG, Pol, and envelope. In the virion, it's coded with nucleocapsid protein, and there are about 50 to 100 molecules of reverse transcriptase per virion. You don't need to know that, just to know that there's more than one. There's also a tRNA hybridized to each of the two viral RNA strands. We'll see the purpose of that in a moment. Now, you may wonder why we have two pieces of viral RNA. They're complete pieces of genomic RNA in the virion. We think this is why these are relatively resistant to ultraviolet radiation and ionizing radiation. Unlike other RNA viruses, they're pretty resistant. We think what happens is, because there are two copies of all genes, if any one is broken by UV light, for example, you can always build the infectious genome by copying the other strand. So the idea is, in a retrovirus particle, the enzyme is always flipping back and forth between both strands, and just randomly it will make a good strand, even if there are mutations in each one. Yes?
I was just wondering if maybe because the enzyme is so slow, that having is there more than one enzyme? Can it do both at the same time?
Is the question whether the having two strands is related to the enzyme being slow?
Or could it go faster with two enzymes?
So there are a lot of copies. There are 50 to 100 RT molecules per virion. So the genomes are probably studded with them, and lots of synthesis is going on. So it could be that those two properties evolved together, having a lot of enzymes and two copies so that you could go back and forth. So just think of this. The enzyme doesn't stay on one RNA. It's always going back and forth and making sort of recombinants, basically. And just randomly, you will eventually get a genome that works, unless, of course, the gene has mutations in both copies and can't be repaired. But apparently that doesn't happen very often. So that's why there are two RNAs, because it helps the virus to be genetically robust. All right, reverse transcription starts with these tRNAs. So in the virion, there are two RNAs. Let's look at one of them here. And we're just going to look at the area at the 5' end of the RNA near the cap where there's a tRNA hybridized. All right, and the tRNA is shown in a different color here. Here's the mRNA 5' end, and the tRNA is hybridized in the virion. So this is a cellular tRNA that gets packaged when the virus is assembling. It's assembled at what's called the primer binding site, PBS. All right, you'll see this acronym pop up later. That's what that stands for. It's simply the sequence that hybridizes to the tRNA. The tRNA is shown here in the middle. That's the actual tRNA as it's found in the cell. This happens to be a tryptophan. Different retroviruses incorporate very specific tRNAs as primers. This is the structure of the RNA in this region without a tRNA. So you can see on the right, this is how the tRNA insinuates into the RNA. It base pairs in this structure, kind of melts it out and gets itself in there. And of course, that 3' end of the tRNA is going to be where the reverse transcriptase begins to polymerize. Now you notice there are all sorts of other labels in this region. And we're going to come back to some of these in a moment. You can see here there's a small r. There's a U5 here, and that'll be relevant a bit later on. Okay, so this is the primer for reverse transcription. When the virus enters the cell, it has in it the genome with a tRNA and reverse transcriptase in the virion. And that's shown on the left here. Immediately, the reverse transcriptase begins to use this as a primer and make the first strand of DNA, negative strand DNA, and that's shown here in light blue. But you can see this tRNA is right at the end of the RNA. Hardly can make anything of any length before it stops. So what it does, as this DNA is being made, the RNA is being degraded by RNase H. That's shown by the little dashes there. Here you can see it's gone. As soon as this single strand of DNA is exposed, it actually can base pair to the 3' end of the viral RNA. Now, these letters are written in a way to imply complementarity. So big R is complementary to little r. All right. So you can see here on the 3' end of the RNA, there's a little r sequence, which is exactly the same as the little r sequence at the 5' end. So when this short piece of DNA is made, it actually hybridizes to the 3' end, and DNA synthesis can continue at the other end of the RNA. By the way, this is all happening in the cytoplasm. The virus has come in. It's sitting in the cytoplasm. It's partially uncoated, but not entirely. And the DNA, the RT, begins to act right there. All right, so far we've primed a little bit of DNA. We're starting to go around the RNA. And here's a diagram of how that's happening. We have RR annealing. Right? The DNA and the RNA sequences are complementary. And that's called a template exchange because the polymerase has gone from this template to this one. It's the same RNA, but it's two different templates. And it's going to happen again later on during reverse transcription. So the enzyme continues to copy. You can see it's made longer DNA in this middle. And the RNase H has degraded most of the template RNA. It's left this little piece here called PPT. PPT stands for polypurine site. And this is going to be a primer for the second strand of DNA synthesis. Before that first strand is even completed, the polymerase, another molecule, begins to make the second strand of DNA. All right? So the PPT is the primer for that second strand. That's probably why it's left behind. Polypurine tract. So now we've come around to the first strand is almost complete. The second strand is elongating, but of course that second strand of DNA reaches the tRNA. It's at the end of the genome. It really can't go any further. However, the primer binding site, which is where the tRNA is left here, is complementary to this sequence right here. So the DNA can continue by hybridizing to the first strand. So that second strand, the dark blue DNA, this area, the primer binding site, is complementary to the negative strand here. It can hybridize, and then the DNA can continue around. All right, so again, the PPT prime DNA synthesis reaches an end, but it is complementary to the 3' end of the minus strand DNA. That's the primer binding site. So it can continue to synthesize. And you can see here, at this point, the PPT is removed by RNase H. And then you can probably imagine the rest. Here's where we left off last time. We have a full-length negative strand DNA, and then the plus strand is elongated all the way around it till it makes a fully double-stranded DNA, which is stretched out and shown down here. Now, I want to show you one thing that's happened here that partially explains all this jumping and weirdness that's going on. The RNA that we started with looks like this on the right here. The 5' end has a little R sequence. So little r simply means a short sequence there that's identical to the big R sequence, the little r sequence at the 3' end. Then there's a U5 sequence, a little U5 and a little U3. So these are different sequences. When you finally make the double-stranded DNA. You see, what has happened is you have duplicated these sequences at either end. You now have a big U3, a big R, and a big U5. Another at the other end, big U3, big R, big U5. And of course, on the negative strand, you would have little U3, little R, little U5, little U3, little R, little U5. And you've got our polypurine tract and our primer binding sites here as well. So what we have done is to make a mixture of the two ends. You see, one end of the RNA has U and R and U5, the other has R and U3, but now we've got all three at both ends. This is called an LTR, a long terminal repeat. It's called that because it's the same sequence repeated at both ends. So all of that jumping of switching of templates is needed to generate these two LTRs. And why that's needed is you'll see in a moment when we make mRNA from this. The mRNA is not a complete copy of the proviral DNA. Transcription begins within the LTR, and you can probably guess where it begins. Look, here's little r at the 5' end of the viral genome. So transcription begins here, and it ends in the little r at the 3' end. So it's missing the U3 and the U5 sequences in that primary transcript, which is the viral genome. So the weird reverse transcription with the two template switches, all that does is regenerate these LTRs so that that when the virus is transcribed, it will be the proper sequence. Okay, so take a look at that on your own. You can see how that happens. But really, the reverse transcription generates the two LTRs. You lose them during mRNA synthesis, and then you regain them again by reverse transcription. It's a neat process. All right, our next question is, which of the following steps occur during reverse transcription of retroviral genomic RNA? All right, number 5 is won handily. Happy to see some zeros there. That's great. So all of these are correct. Priming of negative strands DNA synthesis by tRNA. I showed you that. Two template exchanges, one at the very beginning to go from the first RNA to the first DNA, and then one later on. Degradation of RNA by RNase H for sure. And generation of two LTRs, which I really explained was why this whole process is so strange. All of the above. All right. So the result is a double-stranded copy of the viral RNA plus some. It has two LTRs at either end. And this DNA then goes into the nucleus of the cell. So far, all of this has happened in the cytoplasm. Then it goes in the nucleus and integrates into the host DNA, chromosomal DNA. So here on the top is the unintegrated linear DNA with two LTRs. Here's the host target. And here is the integrated viral DNA. That's the provirus again. The provirus is a very specific definition. It means the integrated DNA copy of the retroviral genome. And from there, transcription by the host cell RNA polymerase II will generate the viral RNA genome. And this is this will be spliced or partially or not spliced to give rise to proteins. It'll also be packaged into new virions. And as you can see, it's short of each end of the LTR. So during reverse transcriptase, the LTRs are regenerated. Now, there is a characteristic event that occurs here during integration, and we'll explore this in a moment. First of all, the host target DNA is duplicated at either end, and that's shown by the color. You can see the host target sequence is in orange. You can see it's been duplicated at either side of the provirus. And the second is that there's a loss of bases at either end of the retroviral sequence. How many depends on the retrovirus. This particular one, you can see, has lost the two terminal T's. And those are gone, so the retroviral sequence ends in CA. And you'll see again why that occurs as we look at this integration step. All right, so integration of that DNA that's produced by reverse transcription into the host cell DNA. This is a step carried out by another retroviral enzyme called integrase. This is a separate protein from the reverse transcriptase and RNase H. And integrase takes the retroviral DNA. The integrase is diagrammed as sort of a dumbbell-shaped protein here. And retroviral DNA and host cell DNA. So the retroviral DNA is in blue. The host cell DNA is in purple. The retrovirus allows the host, the integrase allows the retroviral DNA to invade the host cell DNA. It makes a nick, as you can see here, and ligates the retroviral DNA to the host cell DNA. Now, by nature of how this nick happens, the nick is not making a precise cut at the end, but it's nicking inward a little on one strand. So there's a 5' overhang on the two of the strands. You have a duplication of the host cell DNA. So let's take this through here. You have a nick, an invasion of the host cell DNA by retroviral DNA. It's ligated, as you can see here. And now you see there's a little unbase paired sequence. Those are the two bases that are lost from the retrovirus because they don't base pair with the host cell DNA. So they're clipped off. And then the gap, there's a gap in the host cell DNA is repaired. And that's why you get a duplication, because you're essentially copying both strands, once here and once here. So the sequence, which was only present once, is now present duplicated at either end. So that's why you lose two bases, and that's why you get a duplication of host sequence. So a duplication in an integrated DNA is always a sign that it was carried out by an integrase-like mechanism. This is, by the way, how all of this happens. The integrase is at least a dimer, and here are the active sites that allow the retroviral DNA to attack the host DNA, to nick it, become ligated to it, chew away the unbase paired ends, and eventually be repaired. Yes?
Does the integration happen at certain sites, or is it random?
Okay, so the question is the integration random? Where does it happen at certain sites? And that's in this slide. The integration occurs on every chromosome, as far as we can tell. There isn't any preference for one chromosome. There isn't any preference for any particular gene. But there is a preference for integration into DNA sequences that are wrapped around nucleosomes, so they're bent or underwound. So as you know, DNA transcription is regulated by how tight the DNA is wrapped around a nucleosome, shown at the bottom here. If it's rather loose, which is controlled by epigenetic modifications like deacetylation, the integrase likes to go into those sequences. All right, so this is a key point. Again, the virus DNA will integrate in many, many places on many chromosomes, but it likes open sequences. Presumably, that allows the integrase to work. At the top here is a comparison of integration site preferences. And what we're looking at is the percent integration within genes or at transcription start sites. So here, for example, if you assume random integration, you would get 26% integration within genes, 5% within transcription start sites. You can see, depending on the retrovirus, some of these are the same or some of them are higher. So ASLV, avian sarcosis, leukosis viruses, a little higher than within genes than you would expect from randomly, but really no difference in transcription start sites. Murine leukemia viruses is a bit higher for both. HIV is quite high within genes and slightly higher within transcription start sites. But again, where the virus goes in tends to be in these areas that are underwound or bent. There is a protein that's believed to be important for integration. There are actually quite a few, and one of them is called LEDGF. LEDGF is a protein bound to nucleosomes, and it's thought that the integration complex targets it. So here's a close-up of retroviral infection, the virus coming into the cell, reverse transcription, our double-stranded DNA, which then goes in the nucleus. And it's thought that it has a particular affinity for LEDGF. And the reason why is if you take mouse cells, which are wild-type or heterozygous for a LEDGF mutation, you get 62% HIV integration within genes. And that goes down when you knock out the other copy of LEDGF. So apparently LEDGF is important for HIV integration. Interestingly, at transcription start sites, it actually increases the amount of integration, which is not clear. So the take-home message is it integrates everywhere, but especially in areas where the chromatin is loose. So these viruses can be mutagen. They can accidentally insert it within a gene or upstream of a gene and do bad things. Yes?
Is a virus targeting the nucleosome because those are gene-containing regions which are tightly packed for regulation, and other than the introns of the whole genome, they're targeting those packed places so that they can make sure that
So the question is, is it targeting genes that are wrapped around nucleosomes? But I don't know if that's a consequence of that or something else, because you can see here that for some viruses anyway, the integration at transcription start sites isn't any higher than randomly. As you will see, the virus carries in its own promoter, so it doesn't need to pick up one from a gene. So that's probably why that is low. But yes, I suspect that the genes being wrapped around nucleosome partially accounts for the targeting of those regions and the fact that they're also open. Of course, other areas are not nucleosomes, so why the virus isn't going in there is a good question. I don't think we know the answer to that. So the provirus is integrated into the host cell. The host cell RNA polymerase II, that enzyme we talked about last time, makes mRNA for the virus. There's a promoter that gets built into the LTR during reverse transcription. The RNA polymerase of the host cell recognizes it. For some retroviruses, they don't even need to produce any transcription proteins. All the host cell proteins will recognize this promoter and produce the viral mRNA. And that, of course, is translated to make proteins, to make new viruses. What I find interesting about this whole life cycle is what I've written down here. For these viruses, there is really no DNA replication. There's no RNA replication. There's no viral enzyme that does either process. There's no cellular enzyme. Think about SV40. It uses DNA polymerase to make a lot of genomes, or other viruses that use host RNA polymerase to make their mRNAs. But for this virus, one copy goes in the cell. Of course, every time the cell replicates, that copy is duplicated if the cell is surviving. But the virus doesn't actually replicate its DNA genome or replicate its RNA genome. So quite an interesting, it really is using the host cell to a great extent. So that's what I mean when I say there's no viral DNA replication and no viral RNA replication. The host is doing everything. So to summarize this, the virus infects a cell. The RNA is in the cytoplasm. It's reverse transcribed to a double-stranded DNA copy. This goes into the nucleus. It integrates into the host cell DNA. And there it is transcribed by an LTR resident promoter. It's recognized by host polymerase II into mRNAs, and those can go on to encode viral proteins. So the DNA becomes a permanent part of the host cell. If the retrovirus does not kill the cell, the DNA is there forever. It doesn't go away. There is no mechanism encoded by the retrovirus to get the proviral DNA out of the cell. The only way that the virus can get out is by having the cell's RNA pol II make a viral mRNA, and that can initiate the rest of the replication cycle. Yes?
What about epigenetic considerations, like DNA methylation? If the viral DNA is integrated but doesn't have those?
Right. So the question is, how do epigenetic modifications affect the expression? And in many cells, retroviruses get in the genome and they're silent. So in many germ cells, for example, they go in there, they're silent, and they don't reproduce, they don't kill the cell, and they're just passed on among generations. And people are studying why that is. Apparently, in those kinds of cells, the virus doesn't bother to antagonize any of the modifications that silence its genome. Maybe replicating in a germ cell in the bone marrow or wherever it might be is not of any use to the virus to transmit. But in other kinds of cells where these viruses replicate and where that replication would make sense for transmission, they antagonize the modification so that they can replicate. Integration of retroviral DNA has which of the following properties? All right, number 5, and that's correct. Few and number 2, which of the following? Catalyzed by a viral enzyme, the integrase, absolutely. Occurs on all chromosomes, but preferentially at sites that are bent or underwound because of being wrapped around the nucleosome. That's absolutely right. So if you're picking it, it's true, but other things are true also. Leads to the formation of a provirus, that's the DNA integrated in the genome. Leads to the production of viral mRNAs by host pol II. And so that's all of the above. Yes. So the host pol II does make mRNAs once the DNA is integrated. Yes?
Genomic RNA integrated during reverse transcription, does that mean that it has only one chance
per genomic copy to do that, or?
So the because the genomic mRNA is degraded during reverse transcription, it has just one chance. That's correct. And once that, if that didn't work out for the virus, that's the end of the line. But because there are two copies of the viral genome, it has a higher chance of being successful.
How does it reconcile with the really high error rate?
How does it reconcile with the high error rate? That's probably part of the reason why there are two copies, because of the high error rate. If you are copying two different strands, maybe you have a better chance of making a genome that works. But nevertheless, these viruses make lots of mutations, and they make lots of dead particles as a consequence. Yeah. So the provirus, as I said, is a permanent part of the host genome. If the retrovirus infection does not kill the cell, obviously, the cell survives, and many retroviral infections do not kill cells. That DNA is there forever. The virus cannot get it out except by having its message made, and that way the message goes on to be put into new particles. So all of our genomes, your genomes, every one of your genomes is full of ancient retroviruses, and probably every other living thing on the planet. I hate to make such definitive statements, but there are integrated proviruses. That's a redundant statement. There are proviruses in just about every living thing that we have looked at. And they've been with us for a long time. It's hard to escape the likelihood that they're probably helpful to us. Let me tell you a little bit about this. So these are called retroelements. I think that's a good name for a rock band, right? Instead of retrovirus, retroelements. This is a broad term for retrovirus-related sequences in the host cell genome. And so you can imagine these retroviruses could integrate into many different kinds of cells. When they go in the germline, they're called endogenous retroviruses or endogenous proviruses, all right? That's specifically for germline integration. Because, of course, once you're in the germline, then you stay with the species forever. You get passed on from parents to children forever and ever and ever. And that's what's happened to humans and prehumans for many, 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 many years. These are frequently replication defective. So we have lots of endogenous retroviruses in us. About 8% of our DNA is endogenous retroviral. None of them make any viruses. They're all defective by virtue of mutation. So these viruses infected us years ago and have been sitting in our genomes, and they're mutating, and there's no selection for the most part for keeping the viral functions active. So they mutate slowly until they don't make any viruses. There are some animals out there who have endogenous retroviruses, and they make virus particles like mice. If you go out and trap mice, you will find in their blood low levels of retrovirus particles that are made from endogenous retroviruses. Half of our genome consists of mobile elements, or mobile elements, that are derived from retroviruses. So the ability to move around is in part due to having reverse transcriptase around, and many of these elements are directly derived from retroviruses. So let's take a look at some of these. So these are different retroelements that are found in eukaryotic genomes. So again, just about all eukaryotes have these. Just a few are shown here, human and yeast are basically shown as examples, but there are many, many more. Pick a species, fish, salamanders, anything, they have endogenous retroviruses. And these are the different kinds of elements that you will find there. Endogenous retroviruses, 8% of our genome, and these are, again, integrated proviruses. You can tell that they are viral because they have gag, pollen, envelope. You could sequence, when our genome was sequenced, we could see this. When the Neanderthal genome was sequenced, you could see all of these endogenous retroviruses there. It has two LTRs, and this purple sequence here is the duplication of the host cell DNA that occurs when the viral DNA is integrated. So there's quite a few of those. There are also in yeast things called retrotransposons. These have gag and pol, but not envelope, so they don't make particles. They can't, they're lacking the envelope gene. They have two LTRs and they have a duplication. And again, they are present in very high copy in yeast, and they probably move around. They excise and reinsert. They have promoters that can produce mRNAs that can then jump around the genome. In humans, there are also elements called lines and signs. These have duplicated sequences at either end, so they probably got in by some kind of integrase mediated mechanism, but they don't really have any retroviral sequences in them. This one, the lines have some homology to reverse transcriptase, and that's the only thing, but the signs do not have any of the genes, including reverse transcriptase. They do have promoters, so they can make RNAs, and they probably jump around the genome. You make an RNA, gets reverse transcribed by an RT somewhere else in the genome, and it integrates as well. That's why we have so many of them. And then we have many of what are called processed pseudogenes. These are basically mRNAs that have been copied by reverse transcriptase in our genome and then integrated somewhere. So they have no introns. That's how we can tell they were copied by RT. So many of our genomes have low levels of reverse transcriptase activity in them. And that is continuously copying RNAs and helping to integrate them all over the place. So this is a very dynamic situation. It changes as we evolve. So lots of these retrovirus-derived elements in our genomes. Now the humans have, as I said, 8% endogenous retroviruses, plus lots of the other elements that I just talked about. But all of those those endogenous retroviruses are non-infectious. There's one called HERV-K, human endogenous retrovirus K, which seems to have gone into our ancestors less than a million years ago. So this is probably the most recent infection that we acquire. So the idea here is that over time, we have been infected with various retroviruses, and they have integrated into our genome. And today, what we carry is a history of all these infections that we have. Now, right now, of course, there's an HIV pandemic going on. As far as we know, there are no endogenous HIV genomes in any of us, but it could be that at this moment we are being endogenized, that's what it's called when retroviruses are going into your germline, with some variant of HIV, and that maybe in 10,000 years it will have spread enough throughout the human population that we'll detect it as another ERV. Okay, so this is ERV-K, which infected us about a million years ago. So here's a million years, and this is our ancestor here. So it infected some ancestors of us, not Homo sapiens, which arose much later, but we inherited them through all that. And they're not infectious, but a laboratory here in New York City at the Rockefeller, they took this sequence and they fixed it, because you can look at the sequence and see where the mutations are causing stop codons or doing other things. And they repaired it all, and they were able to recover this virus. All right, so this is a virus that's been dead in our genome for over a million years. And now you can get it replicating in the laboratory. And so it just shows you that these viruses could work, but they've accumulated mutations over time because the human genome, for the most part, doesn't care about allowing these viruses to replicate. So mutations arise, and that's the end of them. But you can fix them and study these viruses now. Now, right now, we know that at least one of these retrovirus genes has been stolen or co-opted by us and many other mammals to make the placenta. So here on the upper left is a retrovirus genome. It has these three GAG polymerase and envelope genes. The envelope is the glycoprotein on the surface of the virus particle. And the envelope allows the virus particle to bind to a receptor. If you take the envelope gene by itself and just produce it in a cell, and that's shown here, and then mix it with cells that have receptors for the virus, the envelope will bind to the receptor, and these cells will fuse and form syncytia, something we talked about some time ago. So the envelope gene has the property of allowing cells to fuse with one another. Okay? Remember that, because that's going to be important. It turns out that many species of animals that give live birth were infected many, many years ago with a retrovirus, and this infection converted them from not having a placenta to having one. And here are just two examples of infections with different retroviruses in the primate lineage. How many millions of years ago this happened? 30 million and 50 million and 30 million years ago, and allowed these individuals to develop placentas. So here on the right is part of what a placenta looks like. There's a layer of cells here that separates the fetal and maternal circulation. It's called a cytotrophoblast. Sorry, it's a syncytiotrophoblast, the one in red. You can see this is a syncytium, basically. It's one giant cell with many nuclei. So it's fused to be a barrier for things moving from the mother to the fetus. This is caused by the envelope gene of an endogenous retrovirus. It's actually called syncytion. So we have in us a gene called syncytion. In mice, if you knock that gene out, they don't make a placenta. So presumably, it helps us to make placentas. We can see the protein in these cells being expressed. It helps convert cytotrophoblasts into syncytiotrophoblasts. And this looks exactly like the envelope of a retrovirus. So the idea is we got infected before we had live birth, before we had placentas, we got infected, and we evolved by stealing the envelope from that endogenous retrovirus and using it to make a placenta. What better example of viruses being good for you, right? They help us to give live birth. If you think that live birth is good. I mean, I think we all accept that live birth is good rather than laying eggs, right? So I would say viruses do good things for us. So this is amazing. This is just one example that has been substantiated, and we can prove it in an animal model. We can show the protein being expressed in the right place. So there are probably other examples as well that we simply don't know about. So again, this syncytion is active. It makes the gene makes a protein, full-length protein that's biologically active. It can cause fusion. So we've maintained it because we need it. The other genes of the retrovirus, we've allowed to mutate and lose function because we don't need those. All right, so that's an endogenous retrovirus that came in millions of years ago, many, many millions of years ago, into the precursors of live-bearing animals. Right now, there is an endogenization going on in a mammal species, the koala. All right, and this is really neat because you can watch it happening in real time. So koalas some years ago, which are native, of course, to Australia, and they get shipped to different parts of the world for zoos mainly, they started getting sick and dying, and they had some sort of leukemia. And it turns out that these animals were being infected by a retrovirus that was causing the leukemia. And as virologists began to study these koalas, they're very defined populations throughout Australia. What they found was that they were being infected with this retrovirus, and it was going into their germline. And not only were koalas spreading it to one another by contact, but the mothers were passing it to the children in their germline. And so a number of studies have been done to look at this. And this pie chart is an illustration of the positive koalas in the Australian population. So you can see at the north here, all of the koalas that have been sampled are positive for this endogenous retrovirus in their germline. So they're completely endogenized. But as you move south, you can see that there are still colonies of koalas that have not been infected. But this has been spreading slowly southward, as you can probably deduce from this series of pie charts. So again, this is happening as we watch. The koalas are being infected. The virus is going into their germline, and it's establishing itself in the population. And in fact, not too long ago, a number of researchers went into museums that keep pelts of animals as historical collections, and they were able to extract DNA from the pelt and show that the retrovirus was in that DNA from the 1800s. So this has been going on for longer than we realize. We just discovered it recently, but the museum pelts tell us it's been going on before that. But that's still relatively recent, because most of these endogenizations happened millions and millions of years ago. Presumably today, as I said before, there may be people walking around who are being endogenized with HIV or with some other retrovirus that we don't know about, and we won't see it for many, many years. Now we have, as I said, we have reverse transcriptase in our genome because some of these endogenous retroviral copies make a low level of reverse transcriptase. And apparently, when we get infected with different viruses, particularly RNA viruses, some of their genomes are copied into DNA, and those get just randomly and accidentally integrated into our genome. So as genome sequences have been accumulated, we've noticed viral DNAs of all these different families in our genome. So we have little small DNA virus genomes in there, which probably is not so surprising because they replicate through a DNA intermediate. But here we have some paramyxoviruses, reoviruses, influenza, rabies, flavivirus, and hepatitis B virus. So short pieces of these viral DNAs are in your and my genome. They're just pieces. They're not biologically relevant as far as we can tell. They just got there because we make a little bit of reverse transcriptase, and if an RNA, a viral RNA, should get into the nucleus accidentally, it will be reverse transcribed into DNA and integrated. So the cool thing about these is that you can date when these viruses were around. So if you have a phylogenetic tree from, say, humans on back 100 million years, you can look at the integration site and see when it became different. So you can date pretty much when these viruses were circulating. And we know some of these were around 150 million years ago and longer. So pretty neat technology. All right, our next question is, which of the following statements about retroelements is not correct? Number 3 is a clear winner, and 5 is getting some action here. So let's see, which is not correct? There are many copies in eukaryotic genomes. That's certainly true. They are currently entering the koala germline. That's true, as I've told you. Those in the human genome produce infectious virus. No, we don't make any infectious retrovirus. We can rescue it by manipulating the DNAs in the lab, but we don't make, as far as we know, any infectious retroviruses. They can be beneficial. The syncytion story, I think, shows that these endogenous retroviruses can be beneficial. All right, the last time here today, I want to talk about another family of viruses, totally different family, that also encode reverse transcriptase. And this is really unusual. They use it in a very different way. And these are the hepadnaviruses, hepatitis B virus. This is a very serious pathogen of people. There are also hepatitis B viruses that infect many other animals out there, including squirrels and ducks and woodchucks and on and on and on. This is what the virus looks like. It's an envelope virus. It has an envelope full of a glycoprotein, and in the middle is the nucleocapsid, which contains the viral DNA. And we talked briefly about this DNA before. It's very unusual. It's gapped, so one strand is not complete. It has a protein link to it, and it has a short piece of RNA stuck on it as well. So today you're going to find out why this genome is so weird. We're going to see exactly what goes on to make this genome. So this virus binds to cell receptors. The nucleocapsid is placed in the cytoplasm. The DNA comes out and enters the nucleus where it is repaired by cellular enzymes. So the gaps are filled in, the protein's taken off, the RNA is taken off, so that it is now covalently closed circular DNA, fully double-stranded, and it can be copied into mRNAs by host cell enzymes. Now, one of these full-length genomes called the pregenome, one of the full-length RNAs, mRNAs called the pregenome, goes out in the cytoplasm where it's encapsulated, and then it's reverse transcribed to form that DNA copy. All right, so this is a little weird because the reverse transcription occurs before the virus leaves the cell. It's like the virus cannot wait to start reverse transcribing. So even though it packages an RNA genome here, if this were a retrovirus, this particle would be getting out of the cell. But the hepatitis say, I'm going to reverse transcribe, and they do it, and they end up packaging DNA. So let's see how this happens. So this is the hepatitis B virus genome. It is a weird genome. It's DNA with gaps and so forth. We're not showing most of that here. But these are the structures that are going to serve as primers for DNA synthesis. Now remember, with the retroviruses, the primers were tRNA molecules. Here, the primer is built into the molecule. It's a piece of DNA. The reverse transcriptase is going to bind this, and it's going to start priming. So let's see how that works. So start on the upper left with the viral genome. This is now in a new particle in the cell. The cell has assembled, the virus has assembled a new particle. It's got mRNA in it. And a molecule of reverse transcriptase called P here, this blue molecule, binds to one of those primer sites and begins initiating. All right, so it makes a short piece of DNA, but then it doesn't go very far. But it turns out that this sequence is a direct repeat of this sequence up on top here. So that short piece of DNA can actually hybridize up here and continue, the enzyme can continue polymerizing and making that first strand of negative strand DNA. Okay, so a little bit of initiation on this primer. A template switch, just like the reverse transcriptases of retroviruses, then you start making the first strand. And here's the full first negative strand of the viral DNA. So it's got a reverse transcriptase still stuck on. Now what's left is an RNA primer. The virus, the RNA H doesn't degrade all of the RNA template because it's going to use this as a primer now. So now we're going back at the top here. Here's the product which we just made. This has the RNA primer bound. The reverse transcriptase, which is not shown on this template here, begins to copy it. But for reasons that are not clear, it does another strand template. It does the second template exchange. One of the theories is that this sequence forms a little bit of a stem loop structure here, and that makes the 3' end no longer base pair, and that's not good for the enzyme. So that instead, this little piece of RNA switches template, goes up here, and then the enzyme begins to make DNA. So now we're making the plus strand of DNA. That's the darker blue. The enzyme reaches the end of the template. It does another primer jump here onto the other strand. And again, they're all sequences that are complementary here that allow this. And eventually, the virus will make plus strand DNA. Now, all of this happens in the particle in the infected cell. Before that particle gets released, this reverse transcription is going on. And it usually stops around here. This plus strand DNA can be a variable length. But you can see you have a full-length negative strand, and that's shown in the diagram of the genome that I've shown you. It's not covalently closed. You can see the protein is bound here. The 3' end, which is shown here, is right next to the polymerase there. And then there's a little bit of double-stranded character, depending on how far the enzyme went. We think the enzyme stops because it runs out of triphosphates. Remember, this is happening in a virus particle, and triphosphates probably can't get into it. So the enzyme starts, it gets this far, and it cannot complete that double-stranded DNA, so it stops. But this is a workable strategy because when this virus now with this genome infects a new cell, it will be repaired by the cell's DNA repair pathways. So apparently evolution has taken this into account, so this is a workable strategy, all right? So again, the particle is assembled with RNA. It starts to reverse transcribe before it leaves the cell, and then it stops because it runs out of triphosphates, and that's why we have this weird partially double-stranded genome. This protein linked to the genome is none other than the reverse transcriptase. And the RNA is what's left of the previous genome that served as a template for reverse transcription. So I think that's pretty neat. So let's compare. Yes?
If the virus particle runs out of triphosphate,
right.
You would expect variable sizes of the gap
here. Yes, correct. And that's what you see.
Okay.
So the, yes. Yeah, some are longer than others. It's not exactly the same length because they run out at different times. Exactly, yeah. So let's compare hepadnaviruses with retroviruses. So in this diagram, we have hepadnas on top, retro on bottom, where in yellow or in box is what you find in the final virus particle. So the retrovirus packages an RNA, most retroviruses, and that RNA gets into a cell, is reverse transcribed to make DNA. The DNA integrates, it makes RNA in the genome, and that RNA is packaged. So retroviruses package RNA, they leave the cell with an RNA genome, and then they wait until infecting the next cell to start reverse transcription. Hepadnaviruses package DNA. The DNA gets into a cell, it's transcribed to RNA, and that RNA is then reverse transcribed in a new particle before it leaves the cell. And again, I don't know why this happens, but the reverse transcriptase simply starts copying as soon as it's put into that particle. So the virus ends up packaging DNA. So that's a main difference between these two. Now, both of these reverse transcriptases, the hepadnavirus and the retrovirus, they encode RNase H because they have to degrade the template. But the hepadnavirus does not encode an integrase. All right, it does not need to make a provirus. Now, it turns out that in people infected with hepatitis B virus, some fraction of the DNA gets integrated into our genome just randomly, not by an integrase-specific mechanism. And this may be part of the reason why you can develop liver cancer after infection with this virus, because it's integrating in the wrong place. But the virus does not encode an integrase. There are other viruses that have similar lifestyles. Here on the upper left, cauliflower mosaic virus. This is a virus of plants. It's quite important agriculturally. It is a virus that encodes a reverse transcriptase, just like hepadnaviruses. It packages DNA. So its life cycle is very much like that of hepadnaviruses, which I've shown you. They package RNAs in the particle that starts to reverse transcribe before it leaves the cell. So the particles that leave cells have DNA in them. So obviously, these have some sort of common ancestor. And finally, at the lower left are what's called the foamy retroviruses. And these are retroviruses that package DNA rather than RNA like most of the others. So I have on this slide retroviruses most package RNA genomes, but there's one family or one example of a retrovirus group that packages DNA. And it's for the same reason that the retrovirus, the hepadnaviruses do. They package RNA in the cell and they begin reverse transcribing before so that the particles that are made contain DNA. All right, so not all retroviruses do this. There is one exception. There's always an exception, as I've said, in biology. So our last question is, compared to retroviruses, hepatitis B viruses. Okay, good. Number five has got the most answers, the scattering of the others. So compared to retros, hepatitis, they do not make a provirus, right? They integrate randomly, but that's usually not the entire genome. They do not prime reverse transcription with tRNA. They have primers built into their genome. They don't need integrase. They don't have it. And they don't carry out reverse transcription during entry like the retroviruses. They do it as the viruses are coming out of the cell. Okay. So it's all of the above.